Hey everybody, welcome back to my channel. So today's topic of discussion is going to be regulatory enzymes. Here we are going to discuss what are allosteric enzymes, how they work, and also about isozymes, which are also known as isoenzymes, and also about zymogens. So let's get started. So first of all, we are going to discuss about regulatory enzymes. These are the enzymes which helps in the regulation of a chemical reaction, and these respond to different signals by increasing or decreasing their activity. So these enzymes are just acting as a regulatory molecule which in turn increasing or decreasing the rate of the whole chemical reaction. So these enzymes bind to the regulatory compounds and in turn help in increasing or decreasing the rate of the chemical reaction. This binding between the regulatory compound and the regulatory enzyme is either reversible or irreversible. So these can easily dissociate or can permanently bind to each other. So this binding can be covalent or non-covalent binding. So first of all, we are going to discuss about the regulation by non-covalent modification, and this regulation is being characterized by the presence of allosteric enzymes. So allosteric enzymes bind in a reversible manner to the regulatory molecule, and this binding is basically non-covalent binding. These modulator and the effector are known as the regulatory compounds. So the modulator is binding to the allosteric enzyme in a reversible manner by non-covalent binding, as non-covalent binding can easily be removed. So here you can see that the effectors or the modulators can be inhibitory or stimulatory. So either they are inhibiting the chemical reaction or they are stimulating the chemical reaction or the binding of the enzyme with the substrate. So in most of the cases, the modulator is the substrate itself. So its binding is somehow increasing the binding of the enzyme with more of the substrate. For example, allosteric enzymes work in feedback inhibition. So in feedback inhibition, what happens is the end product of the chemical reaction is sending a feedback to the initial enzyme or the enzyme which is involved in the first step of the chemical reaction and somehow decreasing its own production. So there is inhibition of the chemical reaction, therefore it is known as feedback inhibition. Now the allosteric enzymes can work in two modes. First is known as homotropic and another one is known as heterotropic. So in homotropic condition, the modulator and the substrate are identical. While in heterotrophic mode, the substrate and the modulator are different and they are binding to different sites of the enzyme. So what we all know about allosteric enzymes, these enzymes are known to be oligomeric, that is they contain many subunits, that is they are made up of many protein subunits and they have two functionally different sites. One is the binding site of the substrate and that site is known as the active site. While the other site is the site where the modulator or the effector binds and that site is known as allosteric or the regulatory site. Now these modulators can be activators, that is they are increasing the enzymatic activity, or they can be inhibitors, that is they are acting negatively to reduce the rate of the chemical reaction. So the activators are also known as positive modulators, while the inhibitors are also known as negative modulators. So this is how the regulatory enzymes work. So here in the blue, you can see this is the regulatory enzyme which has two sites. One is here and another one is here. The first one, this site is known as the active site or the catalytic region of the enzyme, while this site is known as the regulatory or the regulatory protein binding site. Therefore, it is labeled here as R, that is regulatory region. Now, to the regulatory region, the modulator binds. So, this is the modulator M. It is going to bind to the regulatory region of the enzyme, which in turn initiating or increasing the binding of the substrate, that is S, to the active site of the enzyme. So, here you can see that first of all, there was less active enzyme. After binding to the modulator, the enzyme becomes active and in turn it binds to the substrate and forms the enzyme substrate complex. Now, you need to learn that the allosteric enzymes do not obey the Michaelis-Menten kinetics. So, they do not show the characteristic hyperbolic curve that we get during Michaelis-Menten kinetics. These allosteric enzymes show saturation with the increasing concentration of the substrate. So, if the substrate is sufficiently high, then there would be saturation of the enzyme. It cannot bind to more of the substrate. So, there is presence of a sigmoid curve, and this S-shaped curve or the sigmoid curve reflects the cooperative interaction which is occurring between the different protein subunits which are present inside the allosteric enzyme. So, this is how its curve looks. You can see that this is the normal curve that we get from the Michaelis-Menten kinetics, and this is hyperbolic curve. But whenever there is presence of inhibitor, which is represented here by a negative sign, and if there is a presence of modulator, which is being represented here by a positive sign, there is decrease or increase in the Vmax of the chemical reaction. So the mainly the curve is changing to the S shape or the sigmoid curve as compared to a normal characteristic hyperbolic curve, which you can see in the middle. Next type of regulation is the regulation by covalent modification. So here the regulatory enzyme is binding to the regulatory compound or the modulator in a covalent manner. That is, there is no reversibility of their binding. So there is covalent modification such as phosphorylation, adenylation or methylation processes, and there are more than 500 different molecules which are known to modify enzymes by this method only. The most common type of covalent modification which we can see in most of the proteins is the phosphorylation, that is addition of a phosphate group to the enzyme. There is another method of regulation which is also known as proteolytic activation of the enzyme, where the protein is being activated. How? You can see that there are certain enzymes which are present inside our body but are produced in the inactive form. So, first the enzyme is being produced in the inactive form, such as trypsinogen is produced in the inactive form by the pancreas. This inactive form is being converted into the active form by certain cleavages that occur in the protein molecule. So you can see that there is activation of the enzyme by proteolytic cleavage. So the inactive form of the enzyme that we initially get is known as zymogen, which we are going to discuss in more detail in further slides. And the inactive zymogens have the active site that is masked by a particular part of the polypeptide chain. So this masking polypeptide chain needs to be cut so that the enzyme becomes active. So here the conversion is done by the proteolytic cleavage of the inactive form of the enzyme so that the enzyme can get activated. So now we are going to discuss what are isozymes or isoenzymes. So these are the enzymes. We can see that these are the multiple forms of the same enzyme. So same enzyme that is catalyzing the same reaction is existing in many forms, All these forms are known as isozymes or isoenzymes. These only differ in the amino acid sequence or the primary structure of the protein, or in the substrate affinity, that is how efficiently they are binding to the substrate, and also in the Vmax. For example, lactate dehydrogenase is the enzyme which has 5 isozymes, and these 5 isozymes are present in the form of homo or heterotetramer, which are made up of 2 main subunits, that is H and M. So here in this table you can see that these are the 5 isozymes of lactate dehydrogenase. You can see here in the first case there are 4H, that is it is a homotetramer of H subunit of the enzyme. It is also known as H4. It can also be called as LDH1, and it is present in the heart and the RBCs. Another isozyme of lactate dehydrogenase is known as H3M, where 3 subunits of H are present, while a single subunit of M peptide is present. It is also known as LDH2, and it is present in the reticuloendothelial system, that is the endothelium of the retina part of the eye. Another type is also known as H2M2, with 2 subunits of H and M respectively, and it is also known as LDH3, and it is found in the lungs of humans. Now the rest isozymes of lactate dehydrogenase includes HM3 and M4, and these are present in the kidney, placenta, liver and striated muscles respectively. Another type of enzyme is the zymogen that we have earlier discussed. This enzyme is basically the inactive precursor of the enzyme. So this is not the active form of the enzyme. This is only the inactive form of the enzyme which is being produced by the body and being converted into the active form by proteolytic cleavage. So this is the inactive precursor of the enzyme, and it is being cleaved to form active enzyme. For example, trypsinogen, chymotrypsinogen, procarboxypeptidases, all these enzymes are initially formed in the form of zymogen. So all these are zymogens, and these are then converted into active forms of the respective enzymes. The last thing that we are going to discuss today is the ribozyme or the RNA enzyme. So we know that most of the enzymes are proteins, but yes, there are certain enzymes which are not made up of proteins. For example, ribozyme. Ribozyme is the enzyme that contains RNA molecule, not the protein molecule, and it was first discovered by Kali Kruger. And if we talk about its history, then it was first discovered by Scheck in RNA splicing of ciliated protozoan, that was Tetrahymena thermophila, and it was also discovered independently by another scientist, that is Altman, and he named the enzyme as RNase P. So what these enzymes require to work? So these enzymes are known to require certain divalent metal ions such as magnesium. So Mg2+ is being required by ribozymes in most of the cases as a cofactor molecule. And we know that the enzyme is not functional if the cofactor molecule is not provided to that enzyme. If we take certain examples of ribozymes, then there is RNase P, group 1 and group 2 introns that we are going to discuss in more videos, in the coming videos. And there is also hairpin riboenzyme and also the hammerhead ribozyme. So this is it for today's video. In the coming videos, we are going to discuss about biological interactions that are covalent and non-covalent bonds in more detail. After that, we would be over with the biochemistry part of our CSIR NET Life Sciences series, then we are going to discuss about the bioenergetics, where we are going to discuss about the aerobic, anaerobic respiration in more detail. So stay tuned. Goodbye.